together, yeah, we light the candle. As a reminder of Christ's presence with us.
I think so.
The reminder that Christ is the light of the world and the darkness cannot overcome him. Our call to worship this morning comes to us from Psalm 146. I praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God all my life long. Do not put your trust in princes, in mortals, in whom there is no help. When their breath departs, they return to the earth. On that very day, their plans perish. Happy are those whose help is in the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord their God, who made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, who keeps faith forever, who executes justice for the oppressed, who gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets the prisoner free. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord watches over the strangers, he upholds the orphan and the widow, but the way of the wicked he brings to ruin. The Lord will reign forever, your God, O Zion, for all generations. Praise the Lord. Let us pray. Lord, as we gather here this morning, as we gather in your presence, we ask that you would quiet our hearts and our minds and our spirits. You would bring us to a place where we become aware of you moving through us, with us, in us. Lord, however we are gathered, whether it is in this space physically or virtually, may we be aware that we form one body and that you, Christ, are the head. As we gather in this space, as we gather together, as we gather in your presence, Lord, we are also aware that there are things in our lives which cause pain to you, pain to ourselves, pain to others. And we take this time to confess our sin before you. Those things we have said, those things that we have done, those things that we have thought, that have been unloving, that have not been Christ. We confess our sin. We know that you are faithful and just to forgive us all unrighteousness. And so we hear those words, go and sin no more. And we thank you for that in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. I'll ask our steward to do our notices.
Good morning, everybody. A warm welcome to our service this morning, and a special welcome to Reverend James, and we wish you a belated birthday yesterday. May God bless you for you. And also with him we have Reverend David Elliott, their son, his big name. Welcome. A very special welcome to the seventh candidate, Ashley Brown, Tania Jacob, Liam Williams, Conrad Lewis, Jody Mayer, Megan Pieper, and Anthony King. A warm welcome also to those who came to support these families this morning. We enjoy the service as we worship here today. Please adhere to the COVID-19 protocol. Please note the teacher will not greet the congregation at the door. Collection bags will be available at the door as you exit the church. Society stewards on duty this week are Lisa, Bernie, and Janine. For pastoral needs, please contact one of them. The birthdays for the past week. Natalie Ackerman, George Hockley, Reverend Harry James, Elaine Grinfield, and Valerie Davis. Will you please, if you're in church, step forward, including Lorette, who had her 80th birthday yesterday. Lorette, please step forward.
our lives, where there are times where there's new birth. And we thank you for the birth of the November's grandchild, Lord. We thank you for that special moment of becoming new parents or becoming grandparents. And we know, Lord, it's a lifelong journey, and we thank you for that. We thank you for family, for friends to gather around. And we thank you that as we journey through life, you are with us, and that in these moments you celebrate our lives, our celebrations, our ups and even our downs, Lord, you are there. And so we thank you for Loretta, we thank you for who she is, we thank you for your love for her and her love for you. We thank you for her family who's been a support, who've been there, who love, who care. And for these 80 years, it's a gift, it's a special time, Lord. And so we thank you for her health and her vitality and her life and what she does within this community and within this congregation. And so we pray that you would bless her, that you would let her know that she is loved by you and that she is celebrated by you. And the November family too, we ask your blessing upon them, that they would know that you rejoice with them, that you are with them. May they be blessed, may they continue to serve you in various ways, Lord. And we pray your blessing not only upon them, but upon all people, that they may know in their moments of joy that you are there, that you celebrate with them, Jesus. We thank you for this, in your holy and precious name. Amen. Amen. Thank you.
Just one last announcement. Today is a very special day for Ed and the candidates here, because it's going to be a very first confirmation. As he said, being the word, and may God bless you, and you know, may he guide you, hear you, because I think, you know, we all enjoy having you here, and it's a great pleasure for us. Thank you very much. Enjoy the service.
Thank you so much. Right, with that, let us stand and worship God as we sing our opening hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness, O God my Father.
And
what's
it?
Oh, the wrong one. No, I guess not. We're singing what? And can it be? Yes, okay. Yes. I didn't change my order of service. We will stand and sing, And Can It Be That I Should Go.
Thank you.
got the hymn wrong, and she lucky because that was a baptism service, so you were all getting baptized this morning. Let us just take a moment in prayer. Lord, we want to, on this day, praise you, thank you. We've praised and thanked you and expressed our deep gratitude for moments of celebration within our lives, within our communities. And as we gather here as your people to confirm the conferments, to celebrate their new start to a new journey with you within the church, we want to thank you for new life. We want to thank you that you raise up new people to become members of your church, to carry forward the message of your love for the world. And so we pray that as we celebrate this time, that you would be honored, that you would be glorified, that you would be praised, Lord, because we know that all we have and all that we are is a gift from you. And we know that it is through your love for us and your invitation for us that we are able to stand here this morning and just enter into relationship with you, to go through those moments where we celebrate in signs and symbols what you have done in us and continue to do in us and through us. And so we praise you, we thank you. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. I'm going to ask the confirmation candidates to come forward and to stand here. Maybe I should. So it's Ashley Brown, Tamir Jacobs, Liam Williams, Conroy Lewis, Jodie Mayer, Megan Picker, and Anthony Pitt. I'm going to ask you to turn around and face me. Sisters and brothers, by grace through the sign and seal of baptism and in the power of the Holy Spirit, we become God's people, the Church. In confirmation, we are strengthened by the Holy Spirit that we may remain in Christ forever, as his faithful servants and witnesses. Let us pray. Living God, may all who are baptized into Christ be sustained by the Holy Spirit, and through lives of faith and love, may your grace be made known and your name honored through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So I've presented the confirmation candidates. I'm going to be asking you individually a question to which you will respond, I thank God, and ask to be confirmed. And then I will ask the affirmation, the next two questions of you together, and then you'll respond as a group, but obviously individually. Ashley Brown. At your baptism into Christ, God offered you the gifts of his grace and has constantly been at work in your life. In this moment, God offers to strengthen you by his Spirit and invites you to respond. Mia Jacobs, at your baptism into Christ, God offered you the gifts of his grace and has constantly been at work in your life. In this moment, God offers to strengthen you by his Spirit and invites you to respond. Liam Williams, at your baptism into Christ, God offered you the gifts of his grace and has constantly been at work in your life. In this moment, God offers to strengthen you by his Spirit and invites you to respond. Conroy Lewis, at your baptism into Christ, God offered you the gifts of his grace and has constantly been at work in your life. In this moment, God offers to strengthen you by his Holy Spirit and invites you to respond. Jodie Mayer, at your baptism into Christ, God offered you the gifts of his grace and has constantly been at work in your life. In this moment, God offers to strengthen you by his Spirit and invite you to respond. Megan Picker, God, at your baptism into Christ, God offered you the gifts of his grace and has constantly been at work in your life. In this moment, God offers to strengthen you through his Spirit and invite you to respond. Anthony Pitt, at your baptism into Christ, God offered you the gift of his grace and has constantly been at work in your life. In this moment, God offers to strengthen you by his Spirit and invites you to respond. Thank you. So now I'm going to ask all of you to respond at the same time. Do you turn away from evil and all that denies God? Do you turn to God, trusting in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, and in the Holy Spirit as Helper and Guide? I'm going to ask the congregation to please stand. The congregation will respond in the words in red. Congregation, do you believe and trust in God the Father? Trust in God the Son. Can I ask Lisa to come join me this side? And Bernie, this side. If you'll just stand sort of to the side. And Ryan, will you be able to join us too?
Sorry. Well,
in fact, you know what, Ryan, stay there. I'm going to ask Yvonne as a circuit steward and as a leader within this congregation. Stand here as a support, as leaders, to witness and to extend welcome. By the power and grace, Lord, strengthen these, your servants, that they may live as faithful disciples of Jesus Christ. Increase in them your gifts of grace and fill them with your Holy Spirit, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of discernment and inner strength, the Spirit of knowledge, holiness, and awe. Amen. So, because of social distancing, I won't physically be touching. I said to the confirmants, I'll be doing a Bluetooth laying on of hands. Ashley Brown. Lord, confirm your servant, Ashley Brown, by your Holy Spirit, that he may continue to be yours forever. Amen. Lord, confirm your servant, Tamia Jacobs, by your Holy Spirit, that she may continue to be yours forever. Amen. Lord, confirm your servant, Liam Williams, by your Holy Spirit, that he may continue to be yours forever. Amen. Lord, confirm your servant, Conrad Lewis, by your Holy Spirit, that he may continue to be yours forever.
Amen.
Lord, confirm your servant, Jodie Maynard, by your Holy Spirit, that she may continue to be yours forever.
Amen.
Lord, confirm your servant, Megan Picker, that she may continue to be yours forever.
Amen.
Lord, confirm your spirit, your servant, Anthony Pitt, by your Holy Spirit, that he may continue to be yours forever. Promises. And so you will answer with God's help, I will. So will you commit yourself to the Christian life of worship and service and be open to the renewing power of God? Will you seek the strength of God's Spirit as you accept the cost of following Jesus Christ in your daily life? Will you witness by word and deed the good news of God in Christ? And so bring glory to God. Thank you. And then I'm going to ask the congregation to respond to the question where it's in red. Members of the body of Christ, we rejoice that these, our sisters and brothers, have been confirmed. Will you so maintain the church's life of worship and service that they may grow in grace and in the knowledge of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord.
God shall we will.
Amen. You may be seated. I'm going to, now we will be doing a lot of handing out. I'm going to ask that the mentors will come forward. So Adele Jacobs, and Audrey Jacobs, Lisa's here, Mary Kisson, Mary Cavita, thank you, and Heidi, thank you. You'll come forward. So what we're going to do is you get lots of presents now. Some of them which come with obligations, but Lisa will explain that to you. So firstly, we're going to give you a candle. And we ask that you will keep this candle. And that maybe on the anniversary of your confirmation, you will light the candle. And remember, your confirmation. And remind yourself, both of the commitments you have made to God, but more importantly, of the commitment that God has made to you. The commitment to love you and to be with you, to strengthen you, and to lead you, and to guide you. confirmation certificate. You get a confirmation certificate. Keep it safe. Keep it in a place. And they're getting pledge envelopes. So obviously we understand that part of our commitment to God, to the work of God within the community, is that we give as we are led by God to the work in this place. And so you've got, as now members, fully-fledged members of the Methodist Church of Southern Africa, you get a pledge and a pledge number, and we encourage you to contribute, to give, to tithe. I'll be speaking a little bit about more about giving in our service. And then the mentors are being given Bibles. Oh no, Lisa's busy giving the Bibles to the mentors. They are for the candidates, and they've been donated to the church. And the significance of asking the mentors to give the Bibles is just that you're now part of this community. Your mentors have journeyed with you. And there's a real sense in which they will continue to journey with you. But also, you need to start exploring what God is saying to you. And often, I find the Bible a helpful companion in my journey. So there's a sense in which your mentors are saying, there's another mentor. You know? So will you turn around and face your mentors, and then mentors you can congratulate via social distance, you know, the normal for you. Extend the right hand of fellowship and welcome you. We can't. But I'm asking that the leaders, the ones who are called forward, Bernie and Yvonne and Alan Yuya and Alwyn and Lisa, we'll just go to each one of you and from a distance welcome you. Is that good? Okay. But I think the congregation can give them a round of welcome. Let us pray. Let's pray together. Generous God, touch us again with the fire of your Spirit, and renew us by your grace, that we may profess the one true faith and live in love and unity with all who follow Christ. Amen. Amen. You may return to your seats, extinguish your candles, do so gently, just blow them out. And then go and sit there. Thank you. Well done. extinguished a candle after a service and ended up blowing wax all over the pulpit. I'm going to ask our readers to come forward for the Old Testament and the New Testament reading.
Elijah and the widow in Zarephath. Then the Lord said to Elijah, "Now go to the town of Zarephath near Sidon and stay there. I have commanded a widow who lives there to feed you." So Elijah went to Zarephath, and as he came to the gate of the town, he saw a widow gathering firewood. "Please bring me a drink of water," he said to her. And as she was going to get it, he called out, "And please bring me some bread too." She answered, "By the living Lord your God, I swear that I haven't got any bread. All I have is a handful of flour in a bowl and a drop of olive oil in a jar. I came here to gather some firewood to take back home and prepare what little I have for my son and me. That will be our last meal, and then we will starve to death." "Don't worry," Elijah said to her. "Go ahead and prepare your meal. But first make a small loaf from what you have and bring it to me. And then prepare the rest for you and your son. For this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. The bowl will not run out of any flour or the jar run out of oil before the day that I, the Lord, send rain." The widow went and did as Elijah had told her, and all of them had enough food for many days. As the Lord had promised through Elijah, the bowl did not run out of flour, nor did the jar run out of oil. This is the word of the Lord.
Let us pray. Jesus, author of life, speak life to us. Holy Spirit, move in and amongst us. Open our hearts, our minds, and our spirits to receive your word. Father, we thank you that your word does not return empty, but accomplishes its purpose. And we ask that your word will accomplish its purpose in our lives this day. We ask this in the precious name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, our Savior, and our God. Amen.
Amen.
Our I'm standing in the pulpit to preach today for two reasons. Firstly, it gives me space to be socially distant and I can take my mask off. I would do it at the rail, but we're going to be having communion there, so I'm trying to do that so that people can at least hear me and I don't have to shout through a mask. And then also from this I can see you guys better. So my sermon is for everybody, but I'd like to encourage you this morning too. And so you've been confirmed. You've made some promises. You've promised to follow God in the world and in His church. You guys are standing on the brink of a changing in your life. This is one step. Many of you are going to be finishing school in the next 2 years or so. Is anybody writing what you're currently? You've still got at least another year and a bit, maybe 2 years and a bit. But there's changes coming in your life. You'll be entering spaces of leadership eventually. I want to say that all of you are going to find yourselves in places of influence. You may already be finding yourself in places of influence, places where you exert a certain amount of maybe authority or just a certain amount of influence. For us too, we're all in some way or another in positions of leadership. Some of you might only be leading yourself. Others might be in positions of leadership within families. Others might be in positions of leadership within teams, within work environments. Some in positions of leadership in church. You may find yourself in a place where you end up in a place that you would never have thought. I can be honest with you, the day I got confirmed, I would never in a million years have thought I'd be a minister. So you don't know where God's going to take you. You don't. But end up in a position of influence and authority, you will. And it's your choice how you exercise that authority. It's your choice of how you engage with those places where you find yourself being able to make a difference. You can make a difference for good or for evil. You can speak life and bring life into people's lives, or you can bring oppression and death. The choice is yours. We can't do it in our own strength. We trust God. And that's what you've done today. All your promises is, with God's help I will. By God's grace I will. And so, we make promises. We say we're going to follow God and serve Jesus in the world and in the church. And what I want to do this morning is just, I want to look at this God that you have agreed to follow. What is God's nature like? Obviously, I can't explain God fully. We'll never attempt to, but we get glimpses and an understanding of what's important to God, what's on God's heart. And I want to say that God is a God of liberation. Utmost and foremost, God's desire is to liberate people. Why did Jesus come? Was to liberate us from the tyranny of death and sin. Jesus came to set people free. Isaiah makes a very loud proclamation about the fact that he is anointed by God to set captives free, to open the eyes of the blind. And then Jesus, as he starts his ministry, takes the scroll of Isaiah and reads those words. I've come to set the captive free, to proclaim good news to the poor, to open the eyes of the blind, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And Jesus says, this is now being realized in your presence, in your your yoke. God is a God of liberation. God desires to set us free. If I have a look at our call to worship, Psalm 146, just hear what the psalmist says about God as he describes God. He says God is the God who executes justice for the oppressed, who gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets the prisoner free. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord watches over the strangers. He upholds the orphan and the widow. God is concerned about those who are in bondage, those who are suffering, and desires to set them free and bring restoration and healing. That is God's desire. I think if you've journeyed with God, for all of us, we have found that desire of God's at work in our lives. My prayer for all of us is that we're a little freer today than we were 6 months ago or a year ago. That those things that held us in bondage, we're learning to get victory over. Those habits which bring death, draw us away from God and away from love, and we hopefully journeyed and overcome them. Are we more loving today than we were last year? And that's my prayer, that you would experience God's liberating power at work in you. And this has been the start of your journey. You've gotten to know a few things. You know God's desire for you, that you live lives of love. That you don't get caught up in stuff that pull you away from God, that oppress you, that break you. God desires you to be all that He saved you to be. And so as we look at that, we also need to realize that God decided that liberation is not just for us as individuals, but God wants liberation for all people, all communities. But God decided to use us to do that. St. Augustine says that without God we cannot, but without us God will not. God can act without us, but God chooses to act through us. In the parable in Matthew 25, Jesus speaks about giving him a glass of water, feeding the poor, clothing the naked. He chooses to do that through people. That's our mandate, to love, to care, to set free, to bring God's liberation to people. And so you will find yourselves in positions of leadership, in positions of authority, in positions of influence. And you're going to have to choose in those positions, how do you respond? Do you allow God to use you to liberate others? Or do you use your position for selfish gain, manipulation, control, enrichment? We understand about things called corruption. We understand about the oppression of the poor, the marginalized. We understand that. We see it. The problem is we don't often realize that God calls us to make a difference. Even a small difference in the places where we find ourselves. And I want to say that we need to start in the church. God wants to use leaders in the church to liberate people. But how often do church leaders, and I'm not just talking clergy, I'm speaking laity too, how often do church leaders and people of God actually oppress people? And it's not something new, it's happened for millennia. We see in the passage that we read from Mark's Gospel, which is often used to extol the virtue of the widow, is it not? We say, look at this poor widow. She gave everything she had to God. And we think, sure, and we use that passage to encourage people to give. Don't worry, give everything you have, God will look after you. And I'm not saying God doesn't look after us. In fact, God does, but I'll get there. But if we look at the passage, I don't think, and there are many theologians and I agree with them, we don't think that this passage is about giving everything you have to the church. And this is being recorded, so I'm going to have to stay with my words here for better or for worse. I don't believe that's what Jesus is saying. If we look at the passage, when it starts off, what does Jesus say? He says, beware of the scribes who like to walk around in long robes. The scribes were the religious teachers and the lawyers. And to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces, and to have the best seats in the synagogues and places of honor at the banquets. Listen to these words. They devour widows' houses and for the sake of appearance say long prayers. But this still happens, does it not? That people in positions of authority within the church and outside the church use their positions to exploit and manipulate people into giving. And so we use this passage to say to people, give. Give all you've got. Look at the example. Look how Jesus extols this widow. Don't you want to be extolled by God like this widow? And we manipulate people. But I think Jesus is saying, he's just reprimanded the leaders, the religious leaders. He says, look at them. They devour widows' houses. They dress fancy clothes and long robes. They walk in the marketplaces. They're very important. And then he goes to the treasury where the temple tax is collected, and people come and give their tax and their tithes. And Jesus says, look at this poor widow. She's given everything she has to live. All she had to live on, she gave. And the other people have got money, they gave out of their abundance, but she gave everything she had. And for me, the question that it raises is, you say, okay, and where's this money going? What's happening with this money? And because Jesus is criticizing this system, isn't he? He's saying that the Pharisees are exploiting the poor and the vulnerable. And he has an example of a widow. With all that she had, she gave it to these Pharisees to maintain the temple. Yet God remains faithful. That widow is not shortchanged in any manner or form. God will be faithful to her. I don't think we must lose sight of that. We see in the story of Elijah that Elijah goes and he asks this widow to feed him. And she does. And God continues to provide for her in very difficult circumstances. So the question that I'm asking you, that I ask myself, that I ask all of us in any position we find ourselves in leadership, is not whether or not God looks after people who are poor, who are vulnerable. We see God does. The question we need to ask is, are we using our positions of authority to manipulate, to oppress? Are we proclaiming liberation that God calls us to, or are we putting people in bondage, and are we tying people down, are we exploiting, are we using? I want to say to you that when you find yourself in positions of leadership, in positions of authority, when you have to make choices, remember God wants to liberate people and the world and all of creation through you. And whatever decision you make, whatever pressure is put on you, remember make you put additional pressure on people to buy stuff they don't need, or to give where they don't have. Or you're going to remember that you're there to spread the God, spread the light of God in places. When you're in a place where you're in the church as leadership, where I as a minister in a place of leadership, where you as ministry leaders, are we going to continue to minister to people and bring life even though the finances are tight and difficult? Or are we going to use passages like this to try and force people to give more than they're able to? Those are the questions we must ask. The questions we have to ask ourselves is the life of God flowing through me? Am I being faithful to what God has called me? Am I representing God accurately as a God who desires to bring liberation, who desires to set the orphan and the widow and the poor free, to open the eyes of the blind? Please hear me. I'm not saying don't give. Give. Give generously. Give to the work of God. Give as God moves you, as God encourages you. You've been giving this tithe envelopes now, these pledge envelopes. Pray about it. Wrestle with God and say, okay, I'm going to set X amount aside every week, every month, whatever it is, as my contribution to the work of God. And all the congregation will ask us to do the same. Whatever it is, wrestle it out with God. Is 10% a nice margin of blood? As a guideline, but it's not a rule. It's not a rule. In fact, if you have to be, look at some people, they will give more because they have more. Maybe some people give less because they have less, and that's okay. It's between you and God. But please, never ever allow anybody to guilt you, manipulate you into giving more than you feel God's asking you. And never ever manipulate somebody or guilt somebody into giving more. And why? Why do we come and offer a gospel to people? Try and then use worldly means of manipulation and control to enrich ourselves. Why? I think that breaks God's heart. Because remember what we read in our song. That God executes justice for the oppressed. God gives food to the hungry. Sets prisoners free. Opens the eyes of the blind, lifts up those who are bowed down. Lord gives the right, loves the righteous and watches over the strangers. He upholds the orphan and the widow. And God desires to do that through each of us. Whatever you do in life, allow God to liberate others through you. Let us pray. Lord, as we read these texts as we gather here, we're mindful of the fact that there are things in our lives that we do where out of fear, out of greed, out of a myriad of reasons, we fail to allow you to liberate others through us. And so give us the strength and give us the courage, Holy Spirit, to make a stand, to put your justice, your reign, your rule first. To behave in such ways that we bring liberation, that we bring your life to bear in places. That we do not become oppressive, manipulative, or controlling. That we rather bring your life, and that people walk away with a new understanding of your love for them. Lord, we know that there are things we need. We need to maintain buildings, we need to pay for stuff. So move us to give out of love, to give generously, but not in ways that are oppressive, manipulative, and not in ways which cause hurt and harm. Lord, we look to you because because you are the God of abundance, you're the God of life. And we look to you as the God who provides. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to go into a time of communion now. And what we will be doing is, I will ask the confirmants and those with them to come up first, and they will receive communion with their families, and then the rest of the congregation will go through, but we'll lead you through. So I'm going to ask David if you'll come help them. Lift your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Father, all powerful and ever living God, it is indeed right, it is our joy and our salvation always and everywhere to give you thanks and praise through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord. You created all things and made us in your own image. When we had fallen into sin, you gave your only Son to be our Savior. He shared our human nature and died on the cross. You raised him from the dead and exalted him to your right hand in glory, where he lives forever to pray for us. Through him you have sent your holy and life-giving Spirit and made us your people, a royal priesthood, to stand before you to proclaim your glory and celebrate your mighty acts. And so with all the company of heaven we join in the unending hymn of praise.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
We praise you, Lord God, King of the universe, through our Lord Jesus Christ, who on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, he gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me."
Christ is alive. Christ is risen. Christ will come.
Therefore, Father, as he has commanded us, we do this in remembrance of him. And we ask you to accept our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Grant that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we who receive your gifts of bread and wine may share in the body and blood of Christ. Make us one body with him. Accept us as we offer ourselves to be a living sacrifice. And bring us with your whole creation to your heavenly kingdom. We ask this through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be given to you, Almighty Father, throughout all ages. Amen.
The bread we break is a sharing in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one another.
Let us pray the prayer of humble access together.
Lord, we come to your table, trusting in your mercy, and not to be in the goodness of our own. We are not worthy even to gather up the dross under your table, but it is your nature always to have mercy, and on that we believe. So feed us with the body of your blood, Jesus Christ, your Son, that we may forever live in him and be in us. Amen.
us out along the realm of passion. Father, we thank you for the sacrament. We thank you that you have fed us. I pray your blessing on Ashley and on his family as they journey with you. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Food for our journey, and we pray that this communion would be a constant reminder to me and to Liam of your sustaining grace that carries them through life. So we pray for them and their families, your blessing upon them as they go and proclaim your word of liberation. Amen. Conrad. we thank you for Conroe, we thank you for his family and his friends. We ask that you would work in them and through them to be a support for Conroe on his journey as he follows you faithfully all the days of his life. We ask this in your holy and precious name. Amen. Sacrament, which is a sign and a symbol of your life with us and in us. And so, Lord, may Jody know that your life is with her and in her all the moments and all the days of her life. And may you continue to use her for the furtherance of your kingdom, that other people will know that you live through her life. And bless her family, bless her friends, that they may continue to be your faithful servants. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you for this food, for our journey, and we ask that for Megan, that every time she has communion, she will be reminded that you are journey, that Jesus, you are the bread of life, and that you are the vine. And may she forever dwell in you and be united and grafted into you, that you may bear fruit in her life. And I pray for her friends, her family, that will be aware that you journey with them through life. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
We thank you for the gift of journey. We thank you for the start of new seasons. And so we pray for Anthony that as he starts this new season in his life, he will be aware of your sustaining grace that carries him and leads him and guides him. May you use him and his family and his friends to liberate your people. We pray and ask this in Jesus' name. Those who have not received communion can come forward. I'm not sure if there are many. go forth knowing that your presence is with us always. So may this moment in time sustain our journey. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Has everybody received communion who would like? Well, it's been a fairly long service, but it's a good celebratory service. So let us pray together. We thank you, Lord, that you have fed us in this sacrament, united us to Christ, and given us the foretaste of the heavenly banquet prepared for all. Amen. Amen. Our closing hymn is Be Thou My Vision. Let us stand. Slightly different benediction on days when we do communion, and it's a benediction that God will make us uncomfortable and move us. We normally do the poor fund offering with communion, but the way we work communion today, we didn't. But there will be the poor fund retiring offering, so there'll be two. I think we all our bags are the same color, right?
Yeah,
they're
just
marked. Oh, they're marked. Yeah. Okay, so there's the poor fund. Your normal collection. So give as you feel led by God, not by any other standard. Okay. So I won't be going to the ward door and greeting everybody, unfortunately. Those who are visitors, I hope you've had a great service to the confirmants. Well done. Can I tell you a joke? So there's these three ministers, and they got the back problem. in the tower of the church. And so they don't know what to do. And so they get a rabbi who comes and he prays and he does stuff and the bats leave, but the next day the bats are back. And then they ask the Roman Catholic and he comes and he does stuff and he burns some incense and the bats leave, but 2 days later they're back. And then there's a Methodist minister who comes, he does some stuff, and the bats never return. And so the rabbi and the priest ask the minister, so what did you do to get rid of the bats? He says, I confirmed them. So my prayer is that you will continue to come back regularly and be part of an active, vibrant part of this community. And so every time you don't come to church, remember the bats. Okay? Let us say the benediction together. May God bless us with the comfort and easy answers of truths and superficial relationships, so that we may learn from deep within our hearts. May God bless us with anger and injustice, oppression and exploitation, so that we may work for justice, freedom, and peace. May God bless us with tears to shed for those who suffer from pain, rejection, starvation, and war, so that we may reach out our hand to comfort them and turn their pain to joy. And may God bless us with enough foolishness to believe that we can make a difference in this world, so that we can do what others claim to bring justice and kindness to all our children and to the poor. In God's grace we say, Amen. So be it.
Finish.